Hello students, welcome to E-Pathshala. I am Dr. Vasanthi, Professor and Head, Department of Biotechnology, Kamraj College of Engineering and Technology, Virudhunagar. In today's module, we are going to see about enzyme classification and metabolism. For all practical purposes, enzyme classification need to be of two order. One is the systematic nomenclature, another one common or trivial nomenclature. Great thought has been given to give a specific nomenclature to enzymes, which are the biological catalyst of the biochemical reactions. Enzymes, in fact, carry over most of the reactions, biochemical reactions of the body. The objective of the module is to understand the mechanism of enzyme regulation in biological processes, describe the enzymes and its properties that facilitate their actions, identify the major classes of enzymes and the reaction catalyzed by each class, and explain the mechanism and kinetics of enzyme catalyzed reaction. Enzymes are protein catalysts and control the rates of chemical reactions. They are of great specificity, which means an enzyme is very specific to a very particular reaction. Enzymes increase the rate of the reaction by lowering the energy of activation, which is required for the smooth conduct of a biochemical reaction. Catalyst is a substance that increases the rate of chemical reaction without itself being permanently altered. So the reacting molecules are called the substrates, and the substances which are formed as a result of the enzymatic action on the substrate are called the products. The enzyme has a specific site called the active site, which is made up of a specific set of amino acids of a protein to which the substrate binds and thereby exhibiting the reaction. Let us understand how an enzyme works. An enzyme works by binding with its substrate, the molecule whose reaction is catalyzed. The active site is the location on the enzyme where the substrate fits. So here we have the enzyme plus the substrate giving the enzyme substrate complex, and you can see the spot exactly where the substrate, which is red in color, binds to the entire enzyme in a specific pocket, and that pocket is called the active site. Before we know about the classification of enzyme, let us know in detail the structure of the enzyme. Some enzymes require non-protein molecules for their activity. Such conjugated proteins are called as oligoenzymes. The enzyme structure, based on the structure it can be classified, they are simple enzymes where only the protein part is there. However, there are also complex enzymes which are also called as oligoenzymes, where there is a protein part as well as the non-protein part, which is generally called the cofactor. So this is called the oligoenzyme, where we have the apoenzyme, the protein part, plus a cofactor, and the cofactor in itself can be a coenzyme. The enzyme without the non-protein part is inactive, and hence it is called as an apoenzyme and not a full enzyme. The cofactors required as an additional component for to make it a holoenzyme can either be inorganic in nature or an organic compound. So we have two types of cofactors, either it is a coenzyme or it is a prosthetic group. The coenzyme are large organic molecules which are loosely bound to the apoenzyme, whereas the prosthetic groups are usually small inorganic molecules or atoms, and they are usually tightly bound to the apoenzyme. So there is a difference between the coenzyme and the prosthetic enzyme, which are cofactors which are added to an apoenzyme to make it a holoenzyme. The non-protein component, which is loosely bound to an apoenzyme, is generally by a non-covalent bond. And some of the notable examples of coenzymes are the vitamins or compound derived from vitamins like FAD, flavonadenine dinucleotide, flavin mononucleotide, nucleotide adenine dinucleotide. And the prosthetic group the non-protein component are generally tightly bound to the APO enzyme by covalent bonds, and this is called as the prosthetic group. Now that we have understood the structure of the enzyme, let us understand the nomenclature of the enzyme. IUBMB has recommended system of nomenclature for enzymes, and according to them, each enzyme, as I already told you, is assigned with two names. One is called the trivial name, as generally we all have pet names, common names, not our usual full name or the given name. That is called trivial name, common name, recommended name. And another one, which is called as the systemic name, which is also called as the official name of the enzyme. Let's see in detail about it. Each enzyme is characterized by a code number called enzyme code number or EC number, and contain a four figure digits which are separated by a dot. For example, EC, enzyme classification, M dot N dot O dot P. The first digit represents the class to which the enzyme begins. We will be talking in detail about the different classes of enzymes shortly. The second digit stands for the subclass. The third digit stands for the sub-subclass or the subgroup, and the fourth digit gives the serial number of that particular enzyme. Let us take a common enzyme, the first enzyme of the glycolytic cycle, the hexokinase. The EC number is 2.7.1.1. According to the International Union for Biochemistry and Molecular Biology System of Enzyme Nomenclature, enzymes are broadly classified into six major classes. The first one, EC1, is called oxidoreductases, wherein they catalyze a type of reaction called oxidation-reduction reaction. The second class, EC2, is called transferases, where the enzymes transfer a particular functional group. EC3 are called hydrolases, which is called hydrolysis reaction mediating enzyme. EC4 are called lyases, wherein they involve in the group elimination to form a double bond. They are involved in joining of the molecules. And EC5, they are isomerases, wherein they are responsible for isomerization reactions, conversion of one isomer forming to another isomeric form. And the last one, EC6, are ligases, and they are responsible for bond formation, and it is usually coupled with ATP hydrolysis. Let us now see in detail about the oxidoreductases. Oxidoreductases catalyze oxidation-reduction reactions between two substrates. They catalyze the transfer of hydrogen or oxygen atoms or electrons from one substrate to another. The substrate donates one or more electrons to an electron acceptor, thereby becoming oxidized in the process. It is also known as oxidases, dehydrogenases, or reductases. In the given example, you can see catechol gets an oxygen group in the presence by the mediated by catechol oxidases, and they become benzoquinone, liberating hydrogen. So an oxygenation takes place. These some of the properties of oxidoreductases are: they act as oxidases, whereby bringing intramolecular oxygen is the hydrogen or electron acceptor. Peroxidases, reduction of hydrogen peroxide and organic hydroperoxide. They can be reductases by catalyzing reduction reaction. They can be oxygenases, wherein they incorporate intramolecular oxygen into organic substrates, or they can be dehydrogenases, wherein an oxidized substrate by transforming one or more hydride ion. Please understand carefully the difference between oxidases and oxygenases, where in an oxidase, the intramolecular oxygen is the hydrogen or electron acceptor, whereas in an oxygenase, the incorporation of intramolecular oxygen is from inorganic substrates and not into another organic form. Now, transferases, the second group, they catalyze group transfer reactions, and the transferring group could be anything. It could be an acetyl molecule, a methyl group, a phosphate group, or anything, excluding the oxidoreductases which transfer hydrogen or oxygen. So transferases are involved in the transfer of other groups than hydrogen or oxygen, and hence they are called as transferases. And the chemical group is transferred from one donor substrate to an acceptor substrate. Some of the common names of enzymes belonging to this classification group include acetyl transferase, methylases, protein kinases, which are involved in the transfer of phosphate group from ATP, and the polymerases. The third group enzyme is called hydrolases, which catalyze the hydrolysis of various bonds where water is the acceptor of the transferred group. This class of enzyme includes the lipases, the esterases, the nitrilases, the peptidases, or the proteases. These enzymes catalyze the hydrolytic cleavage of bonds such as the CO bond, CN, CC, and some other bonds, including a phosphoric anhydride bonds. A very important class of enzyme. And here in the example, I've shown you the example of nucleotide hydrolases, which bring in the degradation of adenosine into adenine in ribose. The next category is called lyases, which catalyze the non-hydrolytic removal of functional groups from substrates. They cleave various bonds by means other than the hydrolysis and oxidation. I would like you to keep track of the difference between every enzymatic reaction. In hydrolases, the water is an acceptor, and in oxidation processes, one of the component is an electron donor and an electron acceptor. Whereas in lyases, they catalyze the non-hydrolytic, that is without water, removal of functional groups from substrates. They are responsible for the addition of functional groups across a double bond. Add water, ammonia, or carbon dioxide across the double bonds, or they remove these elements to produce double bonds. The fifth class is called as the isomerases, which catalyze isomerization reactions within a single molecule. Here, one substrate gets converted into one product. Of course, there are different kinds of isomerizations like resimizations, cis-trans isomerizations, and mutase reactions. Here, I've shown a conversion of maleate into fumarate by maleate isomerase. The last group of enzyme are ligases, which catalyze ligation, which means joining of two substrate. This class of enzyme require chemical energy in the form of ATP. So here and I've shown pyruvate in the presence of carbon dioxide, ATP and water gives rise to oxaloacetate. In the process, ATP getting converted to ADP. Now that we have understood the different classes of enzymes, we need to know the metabolism of enzyme or enzyme catalyzed reaction. Let me introduce to you a very important concept called activation energy. A progress of the reaction is shown on the horizontal axis, and the free energy, the delta G, is shown on the vertical axis. The transition state of the reaction, which is represented as ABC, is the point of the highest energy. The free energy difference between the reactant and the transition state is the free energy of activation. What do enzymes exactly do? They bring down the activation energy required for a substrate when it is getting converted into a product. What would happen without the enzyme? The substrate would have to spend a lot of energy for its conversion into a particular type of product. That is why we call enzyme catalyzed reaction have the lowest activation energy, where the activation energy is brought down by the presence of the enzyme. Let me explain it to you with an analogy. There is an uphill task of we trying to move a ball by our hand from a higher point in a mountain. As long as we take it to the mountain top, we need to spend a lot of energy. Imagine if there is somebody to lift us and then put us directly onto the mountain top, then the downfall of the ball would be very, very easy. Enzymes do exactly the role of lifting us up onto the mountain top, thereby lessening or lowering the activation energy required for the substrate when it gets converted to a particular product. There are two types of reactions in metabolism. One is called the exergonic reaction. The energy releasing processes, ones that is, which reactions which generate energy, are termed as exergonic reactions. Reactions that require energy to initiate the reactions are known as endergonic reactions. Let me make it very clear. Reactions in which energy is released or energy is generated, they are termed as exergonic reactions, and reactions which require energy to initiate or to start the reaction are called as endergonic reaction. All natural processes tend to proceed in such a direction that the disorder or randomness of the universe increases. This is what the thermodynamic second law also states, that the universe is moving towards randomness, delta S, which we called as entropy. In an exergonic reaction, the change in free energy is represented by a negative number called minus delta G, indicating that the free energy is released during the reaction. I underline, let us not get confused by the negative symbol. If the negative symbol only indicates that energy is being released out of the system, so there is removal of the energy during the process from the system. Exergonic reactions are spontaneous. They are energy releasing. Just check, when the reactants move towards the product, there is a sizable amount of energy that is released, which is indicated by the increase in the free energy. This kind of reaction is called as exergonic reaction. Endergonic reactions, on the other hand, they are not spontaneous in nature, because in order to go from the initial state to the final state, these reactions require a considerable amount of energy from the system outside. They need energy. They require energy. So these kind of reactions are always associated with a positive number plus delta G. Look at the picture here. We'll be able to understand it better. As the reaction product, as the substrate moves from the initial state to the final state, it is a very difficult task. It requires additional energy from the system, thereby increasing the requirement of the free energy, and that is why it is called plus delta G. Only when the energy is given to the system, the substrate can get converted to a product. There is an importance of an additional energy currency molecule in coupling the exergonic and the endergonic reactions. The endergonic reactions require energy to proceed. Coupling an energy requiring reaction with an energy yielding reaction can drive an endergonic reactions. You must be wondering how the exergonic and the endergonic reactions are coupled. That's the beauty of nature. I already told you, the exergonic reactions give away energy. The endergonic reactions require energy. Don't we think that it is quite natural for nature to couple these two reactions, so that the reaction which gives energy, the energy released can be utilized by the reaction which requires it. But however, there has to be a molecule in between to orchestrate, to coordinate this transfer of energy, the release of energy, capture of it, and the transfer of it. An ATP, adenosine triphosphate, is the most common intermediate in such kind of coupled reactions. A coupled reaction is a system of two reactions linked by an energy shuttle called ATP. Substrate B is a fuel like glucose or lipid, and ATP is not a storehouse of energy. It is used as soon as it is available. In substrate A, when it gets converted to product A, in the presence of enzyme A, that requires energy. So where did that energy come from? Another reaction where substrate B was getting converted to product B, in the presence of enzyme B, there was an energy release, and that ATP conversion released an energy which is used by the endergonic reaction. So one reaction releases energy, that energy is utilized by the endergonic reaction. These are both mediated by respective enzyme, and ATP acts as a shuttle molecule transferring the energy from one enzyme catalyzed reaction to another enzyme catalyzed reaction. To know more about the metabolism of enzyme, I need to introduce to you a terminology called enzyme kinetics. Kinetics is the study of reaction rates. Study of enzyme kinetics is useful for measuring the concentration of an enzyme in a mixture by its catalytic activity, its purity, which is called the specific activity, its catalytic efficiency and or specificity for different substrates. Let me tell you, when I mean purity, each enzyme is very, very specific for its given substrate. However, a given enzyme can also act on other substrates, but not at the same efficiency level. So comparison of different forms of the same enzyme in different tissue or organisms help us in understanding the diseases, and it also gives us another understanding of the effects of inhibitors, which can give us information about the catalytic mechanism, the structure of the active site, whereby we can effectively explore or exploit the inhibitors as potential therapeutic agents to slow down a particular enzyme reaction, thereby slowing the rate of a particular metabolic reaction, which is very faster in a given disease condition. Enzyme inhibitors are of molecules that deactivate enzyme activity either temporarily or permanently. There are variety of inhibitors which are being classified. To be more specific, enzyme inhibitors can be classified as specific inhibitors or non-specific inhibitors. Under the specific inhibitors, we have got two classes called reversible inhibitor and irreversible inhibitor. And under reversible inhibitor, we have got two types, competitive inhibitor and non-competitive inhibitor. Another form of enzyme inhibition is also called as uncompetitive inhibitor. We will see about them later. Now, under the non-specific, we talk about agents which generally bring about denaturation of the enzymes, like the difference in the pH, which are brought about the acidic and the basic nature of the medium or the system in which the enzyme operates, the external temperature, the presence of alcohol, the presence of cofactors like heavy metals and other reducing agents. Poisons and drugs are some of the examples of enzyme inhibitors. Let us see about competitive inhibitors. Very simple. They deactivate the enzyme. They compete with the substrate molecule to bind with the active site of the enzyme. The normal reaction is called E, the enzyme trying with its substrate, giving an enzyme substrate complex which breaks down to give the product and liberates back the enzyme. However, whenever there is a competitive inhibitor, instead of S binding to the enzyme, that is a substrate binding to the enzyme, we have the inhibitor binding to the enzyme, and instead of the enzyme substrate complex, we have the enzyme inhibitor complex, and the substrate cannot have any reaction. Examples are antibiotics. The next class is called the non-competitive inhibitor. They deactivate the enzyme by binding to another part of the enzyme and not the active site. So they essentially do not compete with the substrate, but rather they bring about a conformational change in the enzyme, again thereby preventing the substrate from binding to the active site. So they don't compete with the substrate, they bind to a different part of the enzyme, but because of this binding of the inhibitor, there is a structural alteration in the structure of the enzyme, and no longer the substrate can bind to the enzyme. The last part of an enzyme inhibitor, it's called the allosteric enzyme inhibitor. They bind to a part of the enzyme away from the active site, which is usually called the allosteric site. If the inhibition is at a place which is remote from the active site, then this is called as allosteric inhibition. The interaction of an inhibitor at an allosteric site changes the structure of the enzyme so that the active site is also changed. There is a conformational change as I described earlier, and no longer the substrate can bind to the enzyme, because the conformational change happened in the enzyme induces to the loss of the active site. The concluding remark of this unit is, we have tried to understand the nomenclature of enzyme, the classification of enzyme, and the metabolism of enzyme, wherein we know that two enzyme coupled reactions are favored in biological system, where an endergonic reaction is always coupled to the exergonic reaction mediated by two different enzymes, one enzyme mediating an exergonic reaction and another enzyme mediating the endergonic reaction. So classification of enzyme and the metabolism of enzyme are being understood in this particular module.